Repeater Books presents this unabridged recording of Mountains and Desire, Climbing versus the End of the World, written and read by Margret Grebowicz. Introduction, Peak Climbing. On the 29th of May, 1953, Tenzing Norgay and Edmund Hillary became the first humans to stand on the summit of Everest. This momentous human first was also a momentous human last, the last major world news item to be delivered by runner. A courier traveled by foot to the nearest town, from which the information was later telegraphed to Kathmandu and onwards. Sir John Hunt, leader of that expedition and author of the hugely popular account The Ascent of Everest, wrote that his team had climbed Everest because it was an opportunity to enter the unknown. This was more than mere mysticism. The idea that mountaineers had great contributions to make to the advancement of knowledge was shared by many mountaineering writers at the time of the first ascent. Enthusiasts argued that mountaineering was essential for progress in science because so much of the Earth's surface was still uncharted, and only great climbers could reach these places in order to report on them. These days, Everest is anything but unknown. So commercialized that it's become symbolic of a world used up by humans, crawling with amateur adventurers who can afford it, and littered with the corpses of those who don't make it down. In recent years, reports from the climbing season are less about climbing achievements and more about crowds causing bottlenecks and critical levels of trash, resulting in the mountain's new nickname, Mount Trashmore. Another new favorite motif in these reports is that of climbers ignoring other climbers who are struggling, and indeed sometimes actually dying, on the way to or from the summit. How we navigate mountains as a symbolic or semiotic terrain depends on the history we tell of how humans arrived at this point. Recent work by historians tends to focus on climbing as a distinctly European event, a sort of symptom of European modernity. These historians convincingly establish that since the Italian poet Petrarch stood on the summit of Mont Ventoux sometime in the mid-1300s, the first recorded person to ascend a mountain just to see the view from the top, there's been something like a single uniform history of mountaineering, closely following and mirroring that of the modern era. And indeed, by the end of the 18th century, mountains and mountaineers were at the center of many of the developments historians take to be quintessential symptoms of the European modern spirit. Like colonial knowledge production, think Alexander von Humboldt, and the new discipline of aesthetics, think Immanuel Kant. The story here is one of continuity over time and space, with climbers summiting higher and higher peaks, moving eastward from Europe to Asia. In this framework, Everest is just another mountain, the highest one. But there's another way to tell the story. The practice as we know it today began not several centuries, but exactly a century ago with the British Himalayan expeditions. It was actually the Everest Reconnaissance Expedition of 1921, ordered by the British Alpine Club and the Royal Geographical Society, and later known simply as George Mallory's first expedition, that changed the game by inaugurating a culture of celebrity climbers and celebrity mountains. By declaring the summit of Everest the upper limit of the world, possible, that expedition infused climbing with new life. The 8,000ers, or the peaks higher than 8,000 meters, became the ultimate transnational and transcultural theater for life on the edge, the limits of human performance, and eventually, environmental limits. The 1921 expedition forever changed how climbers and their earthbound publics saw not only the practice of mountaineering, but also more generally, what it means to be human, including the role of natural environments in the ongoing creation of culture. The great innovation of the Mallory expeditions was twofold. They discovered a viable route to the summit, roughly the same route on which he and Andrew Irvine would lose their lives 3 years later. But they also changed how humans thought about desire and about the available cultural codes for justifying their desire. When a New York Times reporter asked Mallory, "Why did you want to climb Mount Everest?" "Because it's there." Mallory's cryptic reply became the most loved quote in climbing history. But the real game changer was the reporter's question itself. It announced to the world that mountaineering, till then considered a solitary and silent practice, had an audience, a public that was not only watching but also demanded access to the truths to which climbing seemed to hold the key. This question announced that climbing was the new spectator sport on the scene. By the time of Hillary and Norgay's first ascent of Everest, 30 years later, it was well understood that climbing had a global audience whose first question was why. Meanwhile, no one was asking why about the many other popular sports at the time, like tennis or boxing or horse racing. Hunt's The Ascent of Everest begins with a short foreword written by the Duke of Edinburgh, which explains that the book is not only a full and detailed account of climbing the world's highest mountain, but of the reasons for trying to climb it. And when listing everything that acted in the team's favor and enabled the successful ascent, Hunt ends by acknowledging how important it was that the team had an audience. They were always aware of the hidden force of their public, he writes, and it gave them strength. Some countries have had much longer histories of public interest in the careers of climbers than the U.S. The level of interest in climbing seems more or less proportional to that nation's presence in the high peaks. Britain, France, Italy, Switzerland, and Poland, all countries whose Himalayan climbing is considered top, have audiences dedicated to the latest climbing feats by not only their own countrymen and women, but by all elite climbers. Climbers are household names there, like Michael Jordan or Tiger Woods are in the American consciousness. They have fan bases, TV appearances, and ghost-written best-selling memoirs. My own native country, Poland, treats its high-altitude climbers like national heroes. When one dies in a climbing accident, the nation collectively mourns. Polish even has a word that refers to Himalayan climbing, Himalaism, to distinguish it from the more popularly used alpinism, or alpinism, which other European languages use to talk about all climbing, not just in the Alps. In the course of writing this book, I was often asked the question, do you climb? The subtext is clear. You must climb, because if you don't climb, why write about it? In fact, I was raised on hill walking and come from a family of backpackers and sailors, animal lovers and mushroom pickers, amateur photographers and professional geophysicists. This is the heady cocktail running through my blood that fuels so much of my research and writing interests around wilderness. But this book isn't about that. And I could easily skirt the "do you climb" question by pointing out that mountains have fascinated philosophers since always, and that my academic training is in philosophy. But this book isn't about that either. All of these answers forget that there's such a thing as fandom, and that fan culture itself holds answers to important life questions. The truth is that my way into the vast philosophical conundrum that is the mountains was less via philosophy and more via fangirlhood and popular culture. During my childhood in the 1980s, as Polish climbing became world famous, the U.S. was far behind other countries in its attention to mountaineering. Even so, one of the best-loved American climbing writers of the time, David Roberts, saw the attention to climbing growing and came up with a name for its audience, the vicarious public. Throughout his essays, he argued that the vicarious public was precisely what threatened the very same thing it was after, the insights that climbing could offer into the human condition. The there-ness that climbing always seems to be chasing is the subject of much of his writing from the 1980s for Outside magazine, pieces which clearly sought after what makes mountaineering special. For Roberts, the there-ness in question is something precious and quite vulnerable and easily ruined by the phenomenon of spectacle. In his essay, The Public Climber, from 1984, Roberts argued that as more and more climbers write, photograph, and film their own expeditions, the more the there-ness of the mountains quietly slips away. He suggests that expeditions have changed in part because of the very way that climbers have chosen to write about them. Good climbing, he argues, can only take place under a kind of non-disclosure agreement. Climbers must be able to do what they have to do to survive without having to worry about how they will look in print later, when their friends write their best-selling accounts of the adventure. What is lost when self-consciousness enters the picture isn't just good judgment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.